We have a control CPU with initialized DDR memory booting from code we preload into the cache. We next need to load the rest of the code from the SPI flash, which raises the question, why? Why not write the whole operating system the same way we wrote the boot code? The answer is twofold. First, as I've said, the initial code is loaded from the memory cache. We have about 16 kilobytes of cache, whereas we have 256 megabytes of DDR memory. Limiting ourselves to just what can fit in the cache just makes no sense. But even if we could guarantee that 16 kilobytes are enough, it still makes sense to split the code. Here's the thing. Changing the initial code is time-consuming. Every time we change it, we need to recompile it, which takes just a few seconds, but then we need to regenerate the RTL design and reroute, which takes about 2 minutes. That's a long time to wait after each code change. That time will only rise as we introduce more hardware into the design. So what are our options? The FPGA core reloading is stored on a 16 MB SPI flash. The core itself, however, only takes 527 kilobytes, just a bit over half a megabyte. There is plenty of space left on the flash for anything we want. So here's the plan. Write an SPI controller that can load data from the flash and write it directly to the cache, aka DMA. Put code inside the bootloader to load the data from the flash into memory, and then execute that code. Simple. Of course, there are a few complications having to do with what kind of data we want loaded. First, there's the C++ code we write directly. This includes code and data, both initialized and uninitialized. So all of those are different types of data that was produced by the compiler compiling our C++ code. Beside them, we also need data that relates to the 8-bit side of things. For the Apple II, we need the ROMs, character ROMs, keyboard mappings, auxiliary card firmware, and so on. Since the 8-bit CPU will need to access it, we need to be able to precisely control where all of this is loaded. But we don't want to change the bootloader when we change something there. This means we cannot hard code where this part gets loaded into the bootloader's code. So we need the metadata, i.e. where things go and how big they are, to be stored in the flash along with the actual data. We need to define some format to do so. To understand what the plan is, let's look at how the bootloader is generated. The bootloader is written in C++. I'm using a RISC-V cross-compiler to compile it. The compiler generates object files marked with a .o extension. I then use the standard RISC-V cross-linker to link them into a single executable. The file format is called ELF, which stands for Executable and Linkable Format. It's what most Unix and Unix-like systems use, including Linux and Mac OS X. Of course, the CompuSAR computer isn't the same as a RISC-V Linux machine. To bridge that difference, I'm using something called a linker script. It's a file that describes what memory is available to the final program and which parts of the program go where. This ensures that the ELF file generated describes a program we can run. Since the bootloader is loaded into the computer's cache, we don't differentiate between the memory regions. We use the linker script to dump everything into one continuous blob. Code and data just go one after the other in one sequence. Of course, Vivada doesn't know how to load an ELF file. The next step is to use a tool called objcopy to extract the blob from the ELF file into a binary file. We then translate this file into a textual file called memfile, which Vivada does know how to load. We let the design know that this file is the initial value of the memory we use as cache. Sadly, this sequence doesn't work as is for the second stage code. We want the read-only data to go to a section of memory the CPU can't change. We can save an instruction cache by having only some of the memory available for the RISC-V instruction bus. The 8-bit ROMs need to go where it's easy for the 8-bit bus to find them. We need to scatter the bits around a bit. So here's a revised plan. First, we compile the C++ code as before. We link it into a single ELF file, but our linker script can be more creative. Next, we'll use objcopy to dump individual segments from the ELF file into separate binary files. We'll then create our own format that will allow the bootloader to know which segments go where. At this point, we can also add the ROMs and other stuff that isn't needed for the 32-byte side of things, but is for the 8-bit side of things. Then we can write this to the flash. The bootloader will read the file, parse it, and load each part of the flash to where it needs to be in the actual memory. So what structure should this file have? There are a few constraints. The most obvious constraint is this. The bootloader knows where the file begins, but we specifically wish for it to not know how big it is, how many segments it has, or where those segments need to go in memory. We wish for all of that to be stored in the file. So the format that makes most sense is this. The beginning of the file will have a fixed file header. Since it's in a fixed format, and we know where on flash it needs to be, the bootloader can easily load it into memory. This header can then have identifier markers to make sure we're not reading invalid data. It can also point to a list of data sequences. So the header will tell us how many sections of data the file has and where that list is in the file. We can then read that list into memory. At this point, we have a list of sections, where in the file they start, how big they are, and where in memory they need to go. All in all, this loader isn't too complicated. The header can also have the address where the code is supposed to begin execution from. When the loader is done, it can just jump to that address, which will start the second stage of the boot. Cool. So we have a plan. All we need now is write the tool that extracts these sections from the L file and constructs our file. Except to do that, we need to understand how an L file is built. So what is the structure of an L file? An L file starts with a header starting in the immediate beginning of the file. This header contains a set series designed to identify it as an L file, spelling ELF, of course. The headers also have parameters identifying the file type, what platform it's for, whether it's an executable or something else, etc. The ELF file header also contains two pointers into the file. One is for a list of program headers, continuous bytes in the file that go into continuous bytes in memory. The other is for sections, semantic information about how the memory is to be used. For both, the ELF header tells us where in the file we can find them and how big they are. In other words, an ELF file is almost precisely the same format as the file we were going to create. Instead of building a tool to extract segments from the ELF file to create a new file type, we can just teach the bootloader to load an ELF file as is. It turns out that this is much simpler to do. In fact, it is simple enough for us to go over it right now. We just place the header in as a local variable, just making sure it is aligned properly for the SPI to load data into it, which we do right here. We ask the SPI to load the first size of ELF header bytes into the buffer. Next, we do a series of check value, which just makes sure that the data we got is what we expected, that it is ELF, that it is 32-bit, that is the correct size, that it is the correct version, correct ABI, and that it is an executable for the RISC-V. We then record the entry point written inside the file. This will be returned from the function at the end. Next, we make sure the program headers are the correct size, and we make sure we have enough place in memory for all of them. We then ask the SPI to read them into memory. At this point, it's just a matter of iterating over them and printing out what we find. If the header type is not ptload, we actually skip it. Those might be debug information or comments or anything else that isn't part of the program proper, but something used by something external to the execution. Likewise, if the program header size is zero, then, well, there's no need to load anything. Otherwise, we read the header from the offset written in the file to the location it asks to be in memory. Next, we go over the sections. The initialization is very similar. Now, the only section type that is interesting to us is the BSS section. Upon program execution start, it expects the BSS section to be zeroed, which we need to do in advance. Otherwise, we're quite done. Looking at the code that calls this, we see that we actually call loadOS, store the entry point in a variable, and beside printing it out and deinitializing the flash due to some race that I won't go into, and then we just call the second stage. This line should never be called. Second stage should never return. If we look at the second stage code itself, at this point it just prints that it got here, and that's it. If we look at the execution, we see initializing the memory, memory initialized, we read the flash ID from the SPI flash, and then we parse the program headers, we clear the BSS section, which is of size 0 in this case, because we don't have global variables, and then OS loaded with entry point, and we actually execute the second stage. What's even better is that if we make any change here, getting them to run is simply running make. This creates a file called saurus.mcs, which is a file Vivado uses in order to do the flashing. Then if we go to Vivado, just ask to program the configuration memory, give it the file, type OK. This is all in real time. Nothing is sped up. And we can go back here, execute, reset the FPGA, and we have the code loaded and running on the FPGA itself. Using the compilation result does introduce one complication. The 8-bit ROMs and stuff now need to be incorporated into the ELF file. Previously, they were not part of the compilation. However, this is not as big a problem as one might think. We can fairly easily add them. I find it really cool that my bootloader loads ELF files directly, but maybe it's just me. And that's it, really. Thank you for watching.